From chefs who charmed everybody they met, to those who didn't give a damn about anything or anyone. Here's a look at some of the times contestants shocked the world on MasterChef. And how about we kick things off on a positive note, with a contestant whose charisma knew no bounds. There's no doubt that Christine Ha has a special place in my heart and those of fans too, but I've practically talked her to death recently. So how about some of the other contestants who've earned their place amongst the fanbase's favorites? And this contestant right here had a pretty rough start in the competition. I think Sean O'Neill's journey in season 7 was pretty incredible. When the competition first kicked off, I wasn't vibing with his over-the-top behavior.
Sean is a serious type A personality.
And I was far from the only one with that opinion. Yeah, his domineering tone didn't earn him any friends. But guess what? As the show went on, he whipped out this crazy talent that just stole the show.
Absolutely delicious. Love the texture of the salted caramel.
Yeah, sure, he had his moments of being a bit too cocky and full of himself, but you can't argue with the fact that the dude knew his way around a kitchen. In the end, Sean managed to flip the script, winning not just the MasterChef title, but the cool $250,000 prize that came with it. It's like, who cares about first impressions when you've got some serious culinary chops, right? And, well, that's Sean for ya. As of today, the man's come a long way. Sean's legit a celebrity chef, making waves around the world in his own right. What's more, he hosted seasons 8, 9, and 10 of MasterChef, plus the MasterChef Celebrity Showdown. And that's not all. He's been rocking it on Best in Food on the Travel Channel, doing cooking demos, and even playing guest judge on Home and Family episodes. Oh, and did I mention that he's in TV commercials too? Yeah, Sean's teamed up with Morningstar Farms, showing off recipes he's whipped up for them. The dude's on fire. Well, he definitely seems like he's on a fast track to culinary stardom, and it's not just because of his MasterChef win. The guy's a self-taught master, diving into hundreds of cookbooks and globetrotting to get a taste for diverse cuisine. Speaking about his book release, he said,
"The reason that I did MasterChef was for the cookbook, so I'm honored to be able to share it with so many people."
Trust me, he's become a big deal in modern American cuisine, with that sprinkle of international flair to take things up a notch. But it doesn't stop there. He's also a go-to celebrity consulting chef. From training chefs at a luxury resort in Costa Rica to making a Snickers-themed 5-course menu during South by Southwest, Sean's really taking advantage of every little career booster he can get his hands on. Oh, and did I mention the nationwide partnership he got into with Newcastle? Yeah, calling this dude business savvy would be the understatement of the century. But given the chance, do you know what kind of food he'd dive into himself?
I'm a steak guy. I'm a meat and potatoes.
Same here, bro. Same here. Give me a sous vide picanha any day and I'd be a happy man. By the way, Sean's a hot commodity for private and corporate dinners. Companies like Drip and Canacon are snagging him for his killer kitchen skills and flair for entertainment. And wherever he goes, he makes sure he's paying it forward by sharing the wisdom he's gained along the way.
A sharp knife. You know, so many people are working with dull knives.
Yeah, let that go to show how much of a gem this guy is. He's definitely come a long way personality-wise, too. And it shouldn't come as a surprise that he's taking his show on the road, adding Ireland, Italy, Singapore, and Dubai to his list of destinations. Well, let's let Sean do his thing. Meanwhile, though, I've got another contestant whose charisma knows no bounds. Yeah, I'm talking about Claudia Sandoval, the season 6 champ, who took the trophy in no small part because of her killer Mexican dishes. That finale, though? Pure magic! But I'm getting ahead of myself. What really set her apart from the rest was her versatility. She can handle any cuisine, no problem. She's not just a one-trick pony.
Love the hibiscus fragrance. That's nice. It's sort of perfumed. Delicious.
And did I mention she's got a funny side to her, too?
There's great emotions and there's even tears.
Anyway, I've buried the lead long enough. Here's how the finale kicked off. It was next level crazy, especially when she whipped up tamales with Mexican truffles. During the judge check-ins, she was really confident about her dish, but it was when she tasted her dish that she knew her effort had paid off. She was legit in tears because it was that good. But you have to see Ramsay's reaction to it. He was in shock.
Tasting your own food and then crying. Wow, that's a first for me.
Yeah.
Here's the dish. A wheat locoche tamale with cactus salsa, avocado crema, and chicharron. It was a sight to behold in and of itself. Simple, yet elevated. Ramsay was all about its beauty and finesse, and Graham loved how perfectly balanced it was. Christina also pitched in by just appreciating that something this stellar had hit the plate at all. Later, when Claudia switched to entrees, she served a swordfish with Mexican squash and chickpeas.
Grilled swordfish served over sauteed chayote and fresh chickpeas.
It was a solid-looking dish, though maybe not quite measuring up to Derek's wow factor in the aesthetics department.
A pan-seared venison with root vegetables, a huckleberry sauce.
Ramsay was worried about it being dry. But
this is your most accomplished dish that you've ever cooked in this competition.
He gave her props for presenting her most accomplished dish ever, and Christina and Graham were on the same page. However, the dessert round took a dramatic turn for Claudia.
Water splashed inside when I moved the tray.
Her flan molds were leaking, and she had to start from scratch. Meanwhile, Derek was dealing with a thick batter that just refused to cooperate. But both the finalists got back on track, and just like that, it was time for the final tasting. Claudia presented a hibiscus poached pear dish, and yeah, Claudia ran away with it.
This is a really eye-opening dessert.
Soon enough, the winner was revealed, closing the chapter on yet another intense season. And you have to agree, it was a well-deserved win.
Claudia!
Claudia's culinary journey had its ups and downs, sure, but in the end, she delivered on all fronts. Cut to the present, and she's not just sitting on her hands. You can catch her judging on various cooking shows, like the Easter Basket Challenge on the Food Network. And of course, MasterChef Latino.
I'm back as a judge for MasterChef Latino 2, and I'm so excited.
Yeah, it'd be a crime if she didn't make an appearance there. But that's not all. She's running her own catering and consulting company. Oh, and did I mention she's the mastermind behind a Mexican bakery called Cochi Dorado? The woman's a culinary powerhouse with no plans of slowing down. Claudia Sandoval is on a journey that's nothing short of inspiring. From sharing a one-bedroom apartment with her daughter to owning her childhood home and investing in her business, Claudia's Cocina, she's making moves. She's proving that traditional recipes can be elevated, breaking stereotypes about Mexican food being just burritos and tacos. Her achievements keep stacking up. Hitting number one bestseller on Amazon with her book, making numerous appearances on TV shows, and she's still going strong. It's pretty unbelievable, and she rightly feels blessed. Believe me, Claudia is turning dreams into reality. And, oh, did I mention she did all this as a single mother? Keep it up, Claudia. But this next contestant is a dancer, an artist, and a chef. I'm talking about my boy, Dino Angelo Luciano from Season 8. For real, everybody loves this guy. His Italian dishes were such a hit that even the notoriously picky Joe Bastianich couldn't raise a bad word against them. Dino was quirky, creative, and always kept the judges and viewers on their toes.
Dino was a dark horse who danced his way into the kitchen.
No doubt, he made Season 8 unforgettable. Especially in this challenge, where the chefs had limited time in the pantry but had to whip up three unique dishes. Dino took a risk with his squid ink capellini with calamari, clams, and cherry tomatoes.
Ebony, I know you probably haven't fallen in love with my charm tonight.
The judges had initial doubts, but those same doubts immediately evaporated once they tasted it.
Young lady, you know, tough night, but your timing is spot on.
Ramsay's only critique was about the squid's cooking time, but pretty much everything else was spot on. Still, it was a triumph for Dino, and his bold move paid off. Joe was so impressed that he made him an offer right on the spot.
I mean, however you want to eat it, that's perfectly up to you.
However, that was all about the appetizer portion. Next up, it was time for the main dish. Dino faced a make-or-break moment cooking lamb belly. The lamb he was preparing wasn't done well. The pressure was on, because if he didn't nail it, it could ruin the entire dish. Still, he came out the other side with a rack of lamb with lamb belly sunchoke caponata and balsamic glaze. But the critical question on everyone's mind was whether or not the lamb was cooked to perfection. Chef Sanchez's cut revealed a beautiful pink shade, a perfect medium rare. However, the judges felt the overall dish was too sweet, lacking some much-needed acidity. Ramsay in particular was disappointed, emphasizing that the textures weren't right. He suggested a puree instead. Dino took the critique to heart, knowing he had to bounce back from the setback. The journey continued with a lesson learned in the art of balancing flavors and textures. In the final stretch of the competition, the pressure was on to deliver an outstanding dessert. The judges were looking for something not just sweet, but unique. Ordinary wouldn't cut it. Dino always pushed boundaries, and he wasn't gonna slack off on his big day.
Pistachio tiramisu with an orange mascarpone cream and espresso.
He opted for tiramisu with a twist, espresso caviar. But it left everyone, including the judges, a bit skeptical. Dino had been showcasing traditional Italian dishes with a modern flair throughout the competition, but the espresso caviar took things up a notch. It could honestly go either way here. But Dino managed to complete his pistachio tiramisu with orange mascarpone cream, espresso caviar, and pistachio tulli to the judges. But the judgment? Let's just say it wasn't fully in his favor.
Oh, carrot cake.
I was gonna say exactly the same.
They found it intriguing, but noted that it tasted more like carrot cake. But they still enjoyed the flavor. However, the execution fell short for them, especially with the tiramisu, and Christina not being a fan of the espresso caviar. The competition was intense, with the judges agreeing on at least one flaw in each contestant's dish. This made the final verdict incredibly challenging, as there was no clear winner. The dessert round certainly added a twist to the already unpredictable and competitive season 8. But things definitely worked out in the end. At least for our man Dino.
Dino!
Yeah, as if there was any doubt. But hold on, that was just the beginning. Dino didn't stop there. During his season, he dropped a hip-hop single. That was definitely a new one for MasterChef. And as if that wasn't enough, he went on to open his own restaurant in Montreal, proving that winning MasterChef was just the start of an exciting new chapter for him. Love you, Dino baby doll. Now, moving on to the season 9 champ, Jerone Hurt. He's this amazing guy from Kentucky, a real Southern cooking pro.
A 25-year-old English teacher from Louisville, Kentucky.
Jerone was all about taking his country cooking to the next level, and he had this knack for seizing every chance he got in the MasterChef kitchen. Plus, he's got this super kind and courteous vibe. It's pretty cool. As of today, he is rocking the food truck scene with his own spot, dishing out some fantastic Southern cuisine. Oh, and he's a proud husband and dad, too. Now, back to the show. In the finale, there was a bit of chaos as all the contestants rushed into the pantry for ingredients before getting down to cooking. Jerone, true to his roots, whipped up a plate of Nashville hot quail with fingerling potato salad and poached quail eggs.
And poached quail eggs.
The dish is beautiful.
It was like a throwback to what got him his seat in the competition in the first place. Surprisingly, he'd never cooked quail before, and the taste wasn't perfect, but the judges loved how well cooked and plated it was. Definitely could have been worse, but here's the rub.
Acts the cohesiveness of one conceptualized appetizer.
They felt the cohesiveness was a bit off. The potato and quail combo didn't quite hit the mark. Jerone explains that he was keeping it real to his roots, where anything fried goes with potato salad. The judges definitely didn't disagree, but Joe was a bit concerned that Jerome might be too set in his ways. And of course, as always, he had a few things to say.
It has to be a strict reference to where you come from anymore. It's time for you to fly.
Pushing for contestants to step out of their comfort zones. And well, not all of those challenges paid off. Tough break. But hey, Jerome's entree was a showstopper.
Natto prawns with heirloom grits. A shellfish au jus.
Carabinero prawns with heirloom grits, shellfish au jus, and crispy shallots. It not only looked amazing, but it also tasted great. But again, there was Joe, who still had reservations about playing it too safe. So he confronted Jerome about it.
Tonight, your opportunity to leave.
In response, Jerome was both deep and straight up.
Tonight was about showcasing skill, but also staying true to.
He saw it as more than just sticking to his southern roots. It was about telling his personal story, connecting with where he grew up and his family. The shrimp and grits was an ode to his mother's love for it. Jerome was all about elevating that story. No need for any random French twists. Then came the dessert round, where everyone tapped into their roots. Jerome's dessert, an amaretto chess pie with raspberry coulis and popped sorghum, sounded like the perfect bet, but there was a small issue.
Saucing of a dish like this.
Yeah, messy coulis will do that to ya. He acknowledged that he could have plated it better with more time, but didn't defend the slip when the judges brought it up. But that aside, how was the rest of the dish?
It's got such finesse to put the filling in.
They loved it and appreciated how all three of Jerome's creations told a compelling story of his roots and journey. It was genuine Southern cuisine. Some even Joe recognized in the end. And his performance paid off.
Jerome!
Which I've been highlighting him, it may seem obvious that he took it, but it was pretty surprising watching it live. A welcome surprise for sure, but surprising. But some folks weren't quite as pleasantly surprised. But yeah, Popcorn Kerning said it best. Messy delicious beats pristine good any day in my book. Now, this next contestant has got a special place in my heart, and those of many others too. I'm talking about Whitney Miller, who was the season one winner, making her the first US MasterChef.
Four contestants remain.
This Southern Belle impressed everyone with her down-home cooking skills, earning praise from the judges and ultimately securing the very first MasterChef title. But many viewers were disappointed, as they wanted David to win the season instead. Because according to them, Whitney lacked the technique, leadership, maturity, and creativity. But I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments, because I'm not fully convinced. Anyways, Whitney Miller is as powerful in the kitchen as they come, wearing multiple hats as a chef, cookbook author, recipe and menu developer, and food stylist. Her influence extends globally too, with features showcasing her Southern cuisine in places like China, Dubai, Malaysia, and South Africa. Whitney also writes blog posts and recipes for renowned companies and magazines, including Big Green Egg, Tervis, Penobscot McCrum Potato Company, Southern Living, and more. And she's not just limited to print. Whitney has graced television screens on shows like Good Morning America, Fab Life with Chrissy Teigen. Additionally, she hosts satellite media tours for food and cookware companies and creates stunning dishes as a food stylist, contributing to brands like Hampton Inn by Hilton. Whitney Miller also achieved a milestone as the first Southern chef featured at Chef Dance during the Sundance Film Festival. A hell of an honor. Beyond that, she's had the privilege of cooking for star-studded clientele, including celebrities like Fixer Upper's Chip and Joanna Gaines, Duck Dynasty's Jason Missy Robertson, as well as Tim Tebow and Chris Tomlin.
All right, here we go.
Her culinary skills have certainly made waves in both prestigious culinary events and in serving notable personalities. Whitney Miller continues to shine in just about any medium. She's been recognized as one of TJ Maxx's hero women and as a national spokesperson for the Vidalia Onion Committee and Envy Apple. But that's not all. she's got more up her sleeve, such as being a featured chef for Cooking Panda's Cooking Panda Academy, a celebrity fashion show panelist for Neiman Marcus Cusp, a guest co-host for a daytime talk show, and a food stylist for Hampton Inn by Hilton. Additionally, she's showcased her skills on the Food Network as a food stylist and served as a food expert for product promotions. Not to mention, she's the proud owner of Whitney's Cookies. Gotta say, her resume definitely blows mine out of the water. Nowadays, her Instagram feed serves as a glimpse into her life, featuring adorable moments with her kids and the best from Whitney's Cookies. And you better bet that a ton of fans like myself love keeping up with the ongoing success of the OG MasterChef champ. Obnoxious, rude, vile, this home cook has been graced with a lot of adjectives, and most of them give her a pretty bad name. And maybe it's well-deserved, because Chrissy Biasiello stands out as the first contestant in MasterChef history to threaten physical violence.
I have more enemies than friends, because I never kept my mouth shut.
And this was far from a one-time occurrence. If I had to describe her, I'd say she was hypocritical, bullying, and, well, just kind of a Karen. But you might be wondering if she was playing a heel for the cameras, or if the producers did her dirty. But no, she's horrible in real life too. In 2013, she dropped the N-word in one of her tweets. But that's not all. She also made a distasteful joke in another. Thankfully, her account was deleted after that string of obscene tweets were reported. Serves her right. But IRL shenanigans aside, there was never a moment when she wasn't aggressive on the show. And I couldn't help but wonder how she treated her son in real life. That little dude was a delight.
How good a cook mum is? On a scale of 1 to 10.
11.
Wow.
And this viewer shared the same concerns. Imagine watching your mom making a fool of herself on national TV. I can only hope he was spared that particular brand of torture. Now, Chrissy was up to no good right from the first mystery box challenge.
You think some people like you, some people hate you?
Howard, Natasha, they hate me.
I think the word is dislike. Right from the get-go, she wasn't exactly everyone's cup of tea and struggled to handle, well, anything gracefully.
Maybe I'll go up to her and say, look, I know we have our differences, but good job. But I probably won't.
Unsurprisingly, she didn't seem to strike up any friendships throughout the competition. Maybe she wasn't even capable of it. But let's now get back to the challenge. The cooks had just four basic ingredients on hand. Chocolate, bacon, a tomato, and a potato. Chrissy was the last to present her creation. A bacon and potato frittata paired with a tomato and basil salad. The judges had some pretty good things to say about her dish, but she still lost to Natasha.
Let her have her moment, because I don't think it's going to last very long.
So she had to compete in the elimination round. Keep score here. This will become a recurring theme. Anyway, she whipped up langoustine mac and cheese.
I make lobster mac and cheese all the time.
Now, no shade intended, but didn't she also say this?
I am a single mom on a budget. I'm in a one-bedroom apartment. I sleep on the couch.
I wonder how she was able to afford making it all the time, because lobster ain't cheap. Anyway, while cooking, she caught Howard doubting how well her mixing cheese and shellfish was gonna go.
Mac and cheese and the shellfish would go well together at all.
But strawberry, definitely go with it.
Now, although the judges liked her dish, it didn't win. Jordan's and Jesse's creations were just that much better. In the next team challenge, when Jordan picked Chrissy for his blue team, he made it clear he'd take the lead and expected her to follow suit.
Everybody thinks I'm kinda like gonna take over. Let's go, you son of a bitch.
But things got chaotic, and the blue team ended up losing the challenge.
I'd like to chop somebody's head off for going into this restaurant test.
Again, keep score here. Another recurring theme. When they returned after the loss, Jordan decided to save Howard and James first before securing his own spot. That's when Chrissy got a bit heady about Jordan's choices.
That was a bitch move. In my neighborhood, that'd get your ass kicked. Captain goes down with the ship.
But well, that was just the beginning of her antics. Because cut to the firefighter challenge, and once again, Chrissy was back to, well, being herself.
Beth is like one of those hipster people that I can't stand.
Hold up, hold up, hold up. Then what did she mean by this?
Because she hates me.
She hates you?
Oh, absolutely.
Why would she hate you?
I have no idea.
Okay, so only she can hate people for no reason, right? I mean, the entitlement is making my head spin. But the real question is why anyone would want her on her team in the first place. Because she's the only contestant in the show's history to lose every single team challenge in their season. Which is really something we can only see in hindsight, but her fellow contestants had to get the feeling she was an albatross at some point, right? And, well, the only time she won a team challenge was the wedding one, when her team decided for her not to cook. So maybe they did. Speaking of Chrissy and her tantrums, it would be a mistake if I didn't bring up the Glee cast and crew team challenge. Now, this is when Jesse and Chrissy took charge as team captains. You can imagine how things went for Chrissy, I imagine. When they inevitably lost, she pointed the finger at Beanie, citing his mishandling of the chicken as the reason for their loss. I mean, of course, when should the captain ever go down with the ship, right? And, well, when she had the chance to save herself, she did.
They already don't like me, so I really don't care what they think. My kid would want me to go up them stairs, and that's what I'm doing.
Like, what a hypocrite, right? And look at what she did. She practically hid behind her kids as an excuse for not taking responsibility. What's more, she used her advantage to nominate Beanie for the pressure test, which resulted in him making the mother of all mistakes, serving a liquid pie. As Beanie faced elimination and ultimately left the competition, Chrissy just kept laughing and laughing.
I'm very happy with the results. Mission accomplished.
At least Beanie was a good person. Not good for drama, but you get my point. Okay, on to the next mystery box challenge. I was honestly surprised when they threw Pig's Head into the mix. In season 2's pork challenge, the intimidating cuts were excluded because the producers believed the mainstream American audience might not be into seeing awful on TV. They decided to test the waters in the previous season with a mystery box, featuring organ meats, even including testicles. And apparently, the audience didn't pitch a fit. So in season 4, they decided to bring out the pig's heads. Anyway, Chrissy didn't impress, and had to compete in the elimination round.
You're playing it safe, and you could be in danger. You want to be a smartass? I can be a smartass too.
Just two utterly disgusting personalities. No matter what side you pick, you lose. Chrissy came out the other end of the round with bacon cheddar mashed potatoes, asparagus, and cornmeal crusted fried catfish. However, Ramsey wasn't a fan of her decision to leave the skin on the catfish.
I just never had it any other way.
Are you cooking for the judges tonight to stay in this competition, or are you cooking for yourself again?
And then came Joe, berating her through and through, saying it tasted muddy. To add a dramatic flair, he asked her to shut up, like he was disciplining a third grader.
You think you know it all? Then go cook it all yourself at home. Just listen to me a second.
Add that to one of the fleetingly rare moments I actually agreed with Joe. However, Chrissy clapped back with a response that was no better than an However, given Joe's penchant for drama, it was hard to take his reaction seriously.
That doesn't taste funny.
If you want to talk behind my back, have the balls to say it up here in front of me.
Moving on. Her dish wasn't chosen in the Mexican Mystery Box Challenge, so she had to fight for her life. Again, this time the elimination test was basically a Walmart ad. Something worth mentioning here is that Ramsey back then didn't endorse Walmart. He didn't even utter a word and left it to the other judges.
Walmart sells the highest quality choice steaks. They're certified by the USDA for quality.
Yeah, this blatant ad was kinda gross. And who knew that Ramsey would eventually team up with them to sell his really awful frozen food line, huh? Now coming back to the challenge, there were two baskets. One had strawberries, banana, eggs, milk, baking powder, butter, sugar, strawberry gelatin, and a lemon. The other contained a sweet potato, cauliflower, tomato, mini bell peppers, collard greens, pistachios, cilantro, limes, and undisclosed additional ingredients, all valued at $25. The pricier basket only had a single steak in it, with a shorter time limit of 30 minutes in comparison to the other's hour. Brie, now automatically in the top 10, designated the 1-hour baking basket for the entire group. Except for Natasha, a skilled baker who received the 30-minute steak basket. Devious. Anyway, during the cook, Chrissy ran into a problem with her strawberry muffins.
When I added the gelatin for a little bit of strawberry flavor, it may have messed with the science.
Now, this is where I'm with the people that say the editors will sometimes intentionally screw you over. Listen to this.
Chrissy's not my target, but if Chrissy goes home, that's cool.
So here's the deal. It's so blatantly a mashup of four separate sound bites. I legitimately think they stitched them together to portray Brie as catty. Anyway, what are your thoughts about this? I work with enough audio for the channel that I can tell the sound bites apart. Meanwhile, Chrissy stepped up with her strawberry gelatin cupcakes, owning up to the unorthodox addition right away, confessing that they were disgusting. Ramsay was disappointed, as they all anticipated her excelling in this challenge. The scene then shifted to Natasha, who couldn't help but grin from ear to ear after hearing what they had to say.
This is your worst performance in MasterChef.
But she somehow got out of there unscathed, since she made it to the top 10. This time around, after a really interesting way of having the judges enter, 101 surfers arrived to catch some waves. The challenge was to prepare enough fish tacos to feed the entire beachgoer crowd within an hour. The twist was they were limited to choosing only one type of fish: ahi tuna, cod, catfish, or mahi-mahi. Man, no brainer for me. I'd have gone for ahi tuna. Delicious, and it doesn't need to be cooked to death to be perfect. Anyway, there was another twist. Jesse had the privilege of being the sole contestant chosen as a team captain, and she subsequently stacked her team with James, Eddie, Bethy, and Natasha, leaving the other five on a team of their own. She even got to decide the team captain for the remaining group, Savannah. Now, Savannah opted for cod and experimented with battered, fried, and blackened preparation methods. And Chrissy took charge of the battering and frying.
I fry this cod and it's gorgeous. It was crispy, it was beautiful.
However, her team didn't think so. They were unimpressed with how awful she made the cod taste, so they pivoted to a grilled approach. Unsure of how she could help, Savannah put her on the task of, well, charring the tortillas.
So, I'm just grilling tortillas.
And yeah, they lost. When it came time to name the weakest member of the team, pretty much everyone put Chrissy on blast the first chance they got. Subsequently, the team retreated to the wine cellar to strategize on who to rescue from the elimination round. But things got real tense between Brie and Chrissy, with Chrissy threatening physical assault.
Really? What are you gonna do?
Yeah, I wasn't kidding at the top of the video. But eventually, the team saved Jordan from the pressure test, leaving Luca, Chrissy, Brie, and Savannah fending for themselves, and also tasked with preparing chicken breast three ways: sauteed, fried, and stuffed. And they had 40 minutes to do it. Definitely a really tall order, but Chrissy was super confident.
Luca's never made fried chicken. Savannah's never made fried chicken.
However, right in the middle of the challenge, Luca confided in Ramsay, expressing how everyone was on the same page. They were tired of Chrissy, and she needed to go. And when Ramsay took a look around the room, pretty much everyone was nodding along with what Luca was saying. But Chrissy laughed it off.
Public enemy number one.
Ah, what an honor it must have been. But she wasn't done.
She is the epitome of the girls that I used to beat up in high school. I hate her.
Her behavior was really hard to swallow at the best of times. Even more so here. Confessing to being a bully and openly threatening to hurt fellow competitors is unacceptable, no matter what, even on a reality TV show. Like, if someone is going off the deep end pretty much every day, maybe you kick them off the show for everyone's sake? Now, in 2022, she posted this picture on Instagram saying that she hated the show, and especially the producers. The last time they asked me to come for a 10-year reunion, I basically told them to go F themselves. In those words, but much worse. Good luck to anyone that is competing. I hope production changed their abusive and emotionally torturing practices. I won't be watching. Love, Chrissy, season 4 supervillain. Was Chrissy an asshole? Absolutely. But a supervillain? Giving yourself a little too much credit there, Chrissy. Now, the producers may edit things here and there, but I don't think they can give you an entirely new personality. And let's not forget those tweets I showed off at the top of the video. Well, maybe she's right. They knew better. Back to the season. In the next Mystery Box Challenge, Eddie emerged victorious, securing his safety from elimination. As the winner, he gained the authority to choose an ingredient for his competitors: ham, mushrooms, or shrimp. And Eddie picked mushrooms, a smart choice considering mushrooms are rarely the star of the show in a dish. Half of the contestants received fresh, delightful wild mushrooms, while the others were stuck with some nasty canned stuff. And yeah, Chrissy was one of the unlucky few to be handed a can. Still, Chrissy concocted a canned mushroom cassoulet infused with eggplant and pancetta. And despite several participants also using pancetta in their dishes, Joe surprisingly found Chrissy's execution impressive.
With the product you had to work with, this is a pretty impressive effort.
You know what? She's really reminding me of Russell from Hell's Kitchen here. Terrible bully, aggressive, but has a lot of potential. Somehow.
I made the seasoning for the rice.
Yes. The rice is cooked perfectly.
Anyway, maybe that's just me. But when Brie made grilled sage wild mushrooms with beet and goat cheese salad, her dish was compared to a peaceful walk in the forest, which Chrissy seemed to take offense at.
Friendly vegan hippie thing you got going on, because it's really pissing me off. Just cook and shut up.
Brie wasn't force-feeding her vegetarianism to Chrissy, so why did she get so riled up? Like, I get the stereotype of pushy vegans, but that wasn't even happening here. Just Chrissy being Chrissy, I guess. Well, in the next challenge, the contestants faced an overnight camping session to brainstorm their menu with minimal equipment: a camping knife, a flint for starting a fire, a cast iron skillet, and a wooden spoon.
Walker, hikey, that's like torture.
The teams were initially divided, with one group working on 3 rabbits as their protein, and the other tasked with 6 pigeons. Natasha made the choice to team up with Chrissy, a really terrible move that surprisingly didn't backfire on her, because the judges decided to surprise the contestants by swapping the teams. Natasha really dodged a bullet there, huh? This twist might have been triggered by Chrissy's blunt declaration, expressing her dislike for Brie and her reluctance to have a vegetarian as a team captain.
I don't like the idea of having a vegetarian captain my team.
In a later interview, Brie had a lot to say about it. Also, here's another fun tidbit. The contestants didn't receive dinner or breakfast, forcing them to work with ingredients not intended for their dishes. Brie managed to make oatmeal for herself under these constraints. When Ramsay stopped by to assess their progress, he sampled Brie's creation and was so impressed that he devoured nearly half of it. God, I'd love more behind-the-scenes content getting dropped officially. But moving on, let's skip to episode 18. The producers decided to throw in another surprise comeback. But this one's really out there. Each judge had the chance to bring back one of the previously eliminated contestants. Ramsay went for Brie, Joe picked Lynn, and Graham decided on Beamy.
Of all people, Brie, seriously?
Ugh. All seriousness, I found it odd. Imagine being someone like Eddie. All 3 of these comeback contestants were sent home before him, and yet he didn't even get a shot? Like, what the hell? Anyway, to Chrissy's annoyance, Brie won the challenge. Then, after 20 episodes, the contestants got a taste of a real restaurant kitchen as they took charge at WP24, one of Wolfgang Puck's real fancy restaurants. Natasha and Brie stepped up as team captains, with Chrissy finding herself on Brie's team once again.
Chrissy has a record of 0 wins in team challenges.
Cooks had to master the restaurant's top 4 dishes for a group of 22 guests. A real tall order. The menu featured steamed scallop shumai, lobster lettuce cups, Singapore-style chili prawns, and stir-fried wagyu beef, all cooked using a wok. James was a bit concerned about his team's dynamics. He noticed Brie moving slowly and, given her vegetarianism, worried about her being able to cook meat properly. On top of that, Chrissy's lack of familiarity with Asian cooking didn't really help.
And I hate Asian food.
When they got their hands on the main courses, the blue team encountered significant issues. Chrissy couldn't really grasp how to use a wok properly, resulting in their dishes going out cold.
Chrissy! If the steamer's not steaming, slow down on the salad.
On the flip side, the red team was doing much better, but...
I can't remember what the plate's supposed to look like.
Ramsay, getting war flashbacks from some of his worst Hell's Kitchen services, blew up in a way that made me double-check what show I was watching.
And the shrimp are raw. Who's cooking the shrimp?
Chrissy.
In the aftermath of the Red Team's victory, Bree, James, and Chrissy found themselves in yet another pressure test. Honestly, name a pressure test Chrissy wasn't in. With a 45-minute window to make fried calamari from scratch, they started with 6 whole slices of squid, needing to prep them delicately without piercing the ink sac. The challenge was not only to prep the squid properly, but also maintain a consistent oil temperature. While James had some experience cleaning squid, Chrissy struggled. Shocker, I know. Which got messy real quick.
So how do you think that's gonna keep you in the competition?
I didn't put lemon juice in my marinara.
She survived, as she always seems to. Only to be at her very worst the next day. During Luca's Team Choice Challenge, Chrissy was partnered with Jesse, aiming to craft a 3-course meal using the season's most extensive mystery box yet. Right from the start, Chrissy and Jesse struggled to find common ground. Like, when Chrissy confessed how uncomfortable she was working with the crepes, Jesse retorted with a reminder about how Chrissy abandoned the lobster earlier.
Jesse, it's just sticking.
And she snapped. And got real violent, too.
I'm gonna take this hot pan and smash it in her face.
Chrissy sought refuge in the equipment room to compose herself, leaving Jesse to manage the remaining tasks solo.
I have got to get out of this kitchen right now.
If it wasn't painfully obvious, their 3-course meal paled in comparison to what Luca and Natasha plated. Thus, landing them in the pressure test.
Why do you always let the members in your team take over?
Fair question. Anyway, they were working with chocolate. But finally, finally, Chrissy's efforts fell short compared to Jesse's chocolate lava cake, leading to her elimination from the competition. Geez, about time. But let me get to what you're really here for. After her appearance on MasterChef, Chrissy started offering private chef and catering services and regularly posted recipes on her blog, Rotund Chef. By the way, she's also a breast cancer survivor. Pretty recently, she posted on Instagram saying that she would be taking a break from private chef and catering duties indefinitely to give her body some much-deserved rest. So, I'm kind of conflicted. On one hand, Chrissy was a real piece of work before and during her tenure on the show, but now she seems like she's mellowed out a bunch. Well, I guess it goes to show just how much people are capable of growing. Even bullies, well, former bullies, I guess, like Chrissy. So maybe we show people like her a little more compassion, huh? Who knows how much they're capable of growing? Anyway, what are your thoughts on Chrissy's colorful journey on MasterChef? Going from writing her master's thesis at the University of Houston to clinching the MasterChef title with such class and honor is one of the greatest Cinderella stories ever seen on the show. This is the story of the greatest chef the show has ever seen. Back in 2012, this young prodigy did something totally unexpected. She took a break from her studies to try out for MasterChef. But of course, there was one issue standing in her way. She had lost her vision because of an illness.
An autoimmune condition that affected my nerves, my spinal cord and my optic nerves.
But that didn't stop her from cooking up fantastic traditional Vietnamese dishes.
Coming to MasterChef as the first blind contestant ever doesn't intimidate me at all.
At first, she didn't think much of the audition, didn't take it seriously, just saw it as a potential story to write about. But life is funny. She not only breezed through all the auditions, but ended up winning the entire show to boot.
So ever since being on MasterChef, a lot of people tell me that I'm like the real life Daredevil.
Can we give it up for the one and only...
Christine!
Christine Ha, gotta be one of my favorite contestants of all time. She's been quoted saying to Brain and Life, "By 2007, I realized that my new reality was permanent vision loss and periodic bouts with other symptoms. I remember standing in the kitchen trying to make a peanut butter sandwich. It ended up a mess. I couldn't even make a sandwich. I wasn't sure if I would ever cook again." Oh, but she did far, far more than make a good old PB&J on the show. But before I get into that, that, she currently stands as the esteemed author of a widely acclaimed cookbook, and is a sought-after speaker, too, having graced multiple TED Talks. Beyond these accomplishments, she held the esteemed position of executive chef at Xinjiao, nestled just north of Tinsley Park. She actually just parted ways with them last month to focus on other ventures. Additionally, she's reopened her inaugural restaurant, The Blind Goat, in the early days of 2023. It's located in Spring Branch Village, where she currently resides with her husband of 13 years.
My husband's here supporting me. He's my biggest fan.
Now, the weight of loss has been a lifelong companion for Ha. At only 14 years old, she encountered one of her first when her mother succumbed to cancer. This pivotal experience served as an emotional lodestar, guiding her through her own journey of grief and growth. That aside, Christine's roots trace back to her parents' migration from Vietnam in the mid-1970s.
My parents came here from Vietnam in 1975.
But she was born in the heart of Southern California in 1979, and a significant portion of her upbringing was in Houston. In her earlier years, the foods her Vietnamese parents prepared often evoked a sense of embarrassment within her, a disconnect between the traditional dishes she was raised on and the allure of more normal American fare like bologna and cheese. However, witnessing her mother, who was a dedicated social worker, endure the arduous trials of chemotherapy and eventually succumb to her illness, cast a different light on her youthful perspective. Ha found herself in a complex emotional space, where the teenage desire for normalcy collided with the solemnity of her mother's condition. She felt constrained, unable to engage in typical teenage conflicts for fear of adding to her mother's burden. Yet, in hindsight, she recognizes the profound impact those moments had in shaping the person she is today. The loss of her mother also meant the loss of cherished traditional Vietnamese recipes. As an adult grappling with her visual impairments, Ha embarked on a poignant journey, recreating those lost recipes, and she was armed with naught but Vietnamese cookbooks, her father's recollection, and her finely tuned palate. Also, since MasterChef, she has also appeared in the food series Four Senses.
My show, Four Senses, is a cooking show, and it originally airs on AMI, or Accessible Media, Inc.
Accessible Media, the network behind the show, provides content specifically tailored to people with vision and hearing impairments. And this type of accessibility is something Christine advocated for in her TED Talk on inclusivity in television production. What's remarkable about Christine is her empathy and understanding of the need for a level playing field. Speaking of, she's also very forward-thinking. When one of her competitors, Michael, came out as gay, he feared that his family might not be as accepting as he'd been hoping. But Christine offered him her support, saying, "If it gets bad at home with your parents or whatever, you can always come crash at my place." I mean, Christine, total class act. She has proven time and time again that even when all the odds are stacked against you, you still have the ability to win it all.
For everyone in America, you can overcome anything you want to overcome and get what you want to get.
Seriously, make this your morning affirmation, guys. I know I have. Now, remember the epic clapback she had when Joe asked if her disability could be a disadvantage?
Because I can't see, I won't be worrying about what other people are doing.
I love the fact that you're tasting everything.
I have to, I can't see.
Always focus on the silver lining, am I right? Speaking of Joe, he is known for acting like a jerk and saying stuff out of line. And I made my thoughts on that clear in a recent video of mine. But with Christine, he genuinely cared for her, and that feeling grew stronger as the season progressed, especially by the finale.
As you talk about your food, not only are you able to express it in words, but your face speaks volumes.
Well, after he tried to stick her in the coat check, that is. Check out my video if you're out of the loop on that. Anyway, she talked about the judges' personalities off-screen in a Reddit AMA, sharing, "Gordon and Graham are the same on and off-camera. Joe is nicer off-camera, at least to me, but I've seen him angrier off-camera at others too. Favorite judge would have to be Gordon, because he's so over the top and ridiculous." Now, let's get into MasterChef itself. About time, right? Well, after auditions came the season's first mystery box challenge.
Christine has an aide, but under no circumstances can her aide
interfere with the dish.
While everyone else got a visual on their mystery ingredients, Christine had a bigger hill to climb. All she could do was listen and feel. But she listened intently to every detail, committing each ingredient to memory. And oh, by the way, she had the chance to choose her aide by interviewing three people. And guess who made the cut? Cindy. But of course, there were some ground rules. Christine and Cindy couldn't chat about food at all during the show. Plus, Cindy had a pretty limited role. No cutting, tasting, or cooking. That was all on Christine. When Cindy had to grab stuff for her, Christine couldn't budge from her station. Basically, Cindy acted as Christine's eyes and a second set of much more limited hands. But she couldn't do much else. It was all to keep things fair with the other competitors. Anyway, it was an absolute treat watching her perform. So grounded, so humble, in a competition that's also featured people as cocky as this guy.
I'm really not surprised that my plate is one of the top dishes. These other cooks are gonna have to step up their game if they're gonna wanna compete with me.
More like climbing down a few steps. Well, honestly, Ryan's duck with bananas was just plain embarrassing. And the judges hated it too.
You've gone bananas. That's what's happened. You've gone bananas.
Then, during the first elimination challenge, the contestants faced the daunting task of recreating Joe's notorious risotto. While the others were at the pantry, Christine had to rely on her memory. She couldn't explore new flavors or experiment. She was restricted to what she knew.
Innovation is going to be a big challenge for me.
Yet, when it came time for the verdict, Ramsey praised Christine for her incredible palate. But there was some room for improvement. Fair's fair. And obviously, instead of being delusional, she incorporated his feedback and leveled up. Looking back at her risotto, she laughed and said,
I think when I took a bite, I was like, oh, it's a lot of butter and a lot of cheese. I was like, I think my risotto was a little
mac
too
and,
rich.
Mac and cheese.
Mac and rice.
I made it.
Don't know about you, but I'd still be down for it. Moving on to the military challenge, it was heartbreaking to see her getting picked last.
You know, I have a disadvantage and there's limitations, so I it wasn't a surprise to me at all.
That definitely bumped her confidence down a peg. At that point in the competition, her fellow contestants weren't really able to see past her impairment yet. But they get there. Still though, it was appalling that some viewers jumped to the conclusion that Christine was faking her condition or brought onto the show for entertainment purposes. Look at this comment, for example. Pause if you want to read it. I'm not going to do it the service of repeating what it said on my platform. Just plain ignorant and disrespectful. Guess this viewer didn't know that she was diagnosed with neuromyelitis optica spectrum disorder. Maybe the words were too complicated for them? Anyway, it basically means she can quote-unquote see, although not clearly. But yes, she can see objects within 10 to 12 inches of her face. Otherwise, she says she sees the world as if looking through a steamy mirror after a hot shower. That is to say, not a whole lot. And to reiterate, being legally blind does not necessarily mean a complete loss of vision. Anyway, back to the episode. While Christine being picked last was heartbreaking to see, what's incredible though is how she used everyone's initial underestimation of her as fuel to bounce back stronger. Now, brace yourselves for my absolute favorite moment. It was from the very first pressure test where they had to bake a pie. She was really stressed out and even thought she was gonna get eliminated.
Visually, I'm at a disadvantage, but I know I need to still put that pie together and make it look aesthetically pleasing.
Now, you know how that turned out. But the judges, especially Joe, weren't too sure about her.
I don't know about Christine.
Ready?
With food in the oven, she's at a major disadvantage.
Her competitors weren't sure about her either.
There's no way, I just don't have any more flour.
And she was also battling a major drawback.
The hard thing about baking with my vision loss is I can't really taste it midway through like I can with cooking other things.
Here, she was wrestling with self-doubt, and it broke my heart to watch.
I feel like I need a miracle, but honestly, I
think I'm gonna be going home.
And when Ramsey questioned why she seemed so flustered, it was crystal clear that Christine wasn't trying to dance around the issue. She'd put that pie into the oven at the very last minute, no doubt. She was the only one that cut the apples into cubes instead of slices. She was thinking of McDonald's apple pie and how their apples were also cubes. But what set her apart from many others was her unapologetic honesty. There were no flimsy excuses coming from her, no pointing fingers at other people or downplaying her shortcomings. It was refreshing to see, huh?
What the hell is going on?
Honestly, Chef, there's just no excuse. I just was flustered.
That's called owning up to your mistakes. I had almost forgotten what it looked like. Thanks to all the contestants that have rolled through Ramsey's shows throughout the years. And now, listen hard to what she had to say.
And I'm not saying like it's good to take all criticism to heart. You need to learn.
Wonder if she's ever watched Hell's Kitchen. She'd be shocked to see the ungodly level of narcissism on that show.
But you also have to realize that you're never the best. Like, you're always trying to get better.
Anyway, she wasn't sure what her pie looked like. But Ramsey decided to fill in the blanks for her.
I think it probably looks like a pile of rubbish.
Visually, it looks stunning.
Success is so much sweeter when achieved against all odds. And Ramsey's words were a lifeline for her. And with his trademark blend of empathy and expertise, Ramsey reached out, offering both reassurance and hope.
So stop doubting yourself. Be bold.
Yes, Chef.
Okay?
You know, the way he explained how awesome that pie was to Christine was pretty darn impressive. He didn't just talk about it, he made sure to incorporate all of Christine's senses too. He really went above and beyond to make Christine feel how well she had done. I mean, scraping that pie's top to showcase its crispy glaze, cutting through it with that satisfying crunch, and tapping its bottom.
Can you hear that? On the balcony, you can hear that, right?
Yes, sir.
All of that spoke volumes about how amazing that pie was, even without needing to see it.
Pie underneath, the pastry looks cooked.
It was really beautiful. Now, these next lines from Ramsey weren't just for Christine. They healed a part of me, too. And they are meant to be heard by everyone who developed a critical view of themselves. Maybe you were told you were never good enough. Maybe you were never encouraged as a child. Maybe nobody ever believed in you. Whenever you find yourself questioning your self-worth, I hope you come back to this video and listen to these words very carefully.
Stop feeling upset with yourself, okay?
Humility is a strength. Ramsey's autobiography is named Humble Pie, but what good is it if it comes at your own expense, right? And Ramsey ensured Christine realized what her true potential was.
And it's intact, right in front of your very eyes. I have a wedge of a beautiful apple pie.
See what I mean? She was truly the underdog. And this test all but proved who the winner would be.
The flavor's amazing. Okay? It's delicious. So well done.
Now, on to the second mystery box challenge. The inside of those boxes were pretty much a vegan's worst nightmare.
Veal brains, lamb hearts, bull's testicles, pig's kidney, chicken livers, cow's tongue.
While Christine felt glad she was spared the ghastly sight, she eventually made panko fried sweetbreads served with bok choy.
Really terrific. A great accomplishment.
Thank you so much, sir.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And yeah, it was a hit. However, Ryan turned out to be the winner this time. This meant Christine had to compete in the subsequent elimination challenge. And Ryan smartly strategized to exploit all her weaknesses. He was in charge of choosing who could cook with a live crab and who would cook with canned meat.
I think she might be a little bit thrown by working with the fresh crab. And I think it might be a little bit of a tougher ingredient for her.
And Ryan spared no expense in trying to eliminate his strongest competitor. Now, this was a cunning move, and I'm not the only one who thought so.
I think I'm the only one in the MasterChef kitchen that's hoping for the canned crab.
Monty stole my words when she said,
"What kind of a d- gives a live crab to the blind chick?"
But in Christine's reaction video to that episode, she revealed she was actually cool with it and held no grudge against Ryan. instead of getting all worked up, she actually appreciated it. Why? Because it showed that Ryan saw her as a real contender, someone to take seriously in the competition. And just like Ryan expected, Christine had some trouble with that crab, and at one point, it got her. Ouch! She even needed medical help in the aftermath.
It pierced me. Medic.
Now, would you look at that evil grin on Ryan's face? However, the judges, understandably, were a tad worried. I mean, who wouldn't be, right? But guess what? When judgment came, Christine did what she did best.
You cook every freaking time like an angel. Good job.
Thank you,
seriously.
Chef.
Yep, she knocked it right out of the park.
Are you really blind?
Yes, Chef, I am.
What color eyes have I got?
I have no idea, Chef.
Ramsay was straight up floored. I mean, he was in complete disbelief. It was a total game changer. Ryan, who probably thought he'd throw Christine off her game, ended up making Christine nigh unstoppable. Oh yeah, Christine's dish was so phenomenal that his strategy completely backfired. And then, in the breakfast challenge, we got a taste of her vocal leadership. And needless to say, the judges were impressed yet again.
Christine is so vocal, it's extraordinary.
Well, she is really kind of rising to the top, as we say. She's taking control.
Yep. She led her team to victory.
I feel awesome, like I've climbed that entire ladder from bottom to top.
Red team, congratulations.
However, in episode 8's elimination challenge, where they had to bake strawberry shortcake, Christine faced a bit of a hiccup.
Strawberry shortcake is a classic for a reason, so I'm struggling to find the strawberries.
Now, this person even said that Christine should have been eliminated over this because she made an entirely different dish. But hey, the internet's filled with haters and flat earth conspiracy theorists, so obviously, at least a couple of people were gonna be upset Christine got out of that situation unscathed. And according to this viewer, the finale needs a closer look too. They pointed out that Christine's appetizer was a basic Thai salad, downplaying the importance of the protein element. Her main course consisted of a straightforward pork dish served with rice, stir-fried veggies, and a fried egg. They noted that Christine stuck to what she knew, resulting in dishes that were passable, but hardly innovative. Furthermore, they raised a question. Would a win for Josh have made a significant impact on his life? They also expressed that it seemed unfair for Josh to compete against Christine, whose victory might have been more appealing to the general audience. They concluded by stating that, irrespective of Josh's efforts, if Christine managed to present something edible, Josh would have inevitably faced defeat on that day. And I mean, that's fair criticism. I don't buy it, but it's fair to think about. Now, this next viewer here also thought that Christine stuck within her comfort zone, consistently preparing Thai or Asian-inspired dishes without exploring beyond those boundaries, not just in the finale, but during the rest of the show too. They said this showcased a form of bias on the judges' part. They suggested that the judges might have been hesitant to eliminate Christine due to her visual impairment, leading them to favor her to avoid controversy. But hear me out. In spite of her impairments, her performance still outshone others through sheer culinary skill. Yeah, Josh presented a more refined menu, but execution is key. Let's look back. Josh's lobsters turned inedible, and his pie had a really greasy bacon, while Christine's minor errors were overshadowed by her overall execution. Her appetizer might have lacked crab, and the entree seemed a bit messy, and the dessert didn't fully capture the lime flavor, but these were comparably minor slip-ups. Did she play it safe? Sure. Would she have lost if Josh executed better? Probably. But that's not what happened. And multiple contestants even considered her a strong contender for the win too. This indicates a general consensus among peers and competitors, independent of any bias from the judges. To quote Christine herself, "Our season was especially friendly. It was, for the most part, healthy competition. I, along with many others, weren't out to screw our fellow competitors in order to win. Many of us wanted to win simply based on true merits. Moreover, while some may argue about potential bias from the judges, the overwhelming support and inspiration Christine garnered from fans, it's huge. And you can definitely count me among them. But what about you? Don't forget to share your thoughts in the comments below. And before you leave, don't forget to hit that like, subscribe, and turn on my post notifications too. And if you enjoyed this video, you have to check out the next one right here. It's even better.